Colorado is a leader at the forefront in the legalization of marijuana. But what are the real impacts? Tom Goman is the director of the Rocky Mountain High-Intensity Drug Trafficking Area. He tracks local drug trends and the impact of local legal weed. He joins Denver DA Mitch Morrissey on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Hello, everyone. I'm Tamara Banks. Welcome to this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Mitch, great to see you.
Good to see you, Tamara.
I'm so happy to have our guest here today, Tom Goman. Thanks so much for taking time out of your busy day.
Thank you, Tamara. Glad to be here.
Thanks. Well, talk about what Rocky Mountain HIDA is and what do you guys actually do?
Actually, it's a program out of the Office of National Drug Control Policy, which is out of the White House. Our primary function is to take state, federal, and local law enforcement, put them together, and go after drug trafficking organizations. The bigger, the better. The ones that affect us internationally and nationally. So that's our primary mission. Then we do training. We have an intelligence center, and we do public education.
So before we go any further, tell us a little bit more about your background. How did you get to this position?
Well, I started out in California way, way, way back when. I spent about 10 years working undercover in California in the Bay Area and Sacramento area. I ended up becoming the deputy chief in charge of statewide operations. And then I retired and I was offered this job out here in Colorado.
Well, this is great to have you here in Colorado.
Thank you.
Mitch, talk a little bit about how the Rocky Mountain HIDA sort of interfaces with your office and why that's important.
Where I interface the most with Tom, and I got to tell you, in my 32 years, I've met a lot of people in this business, a lot of interesting people, a lot of people with great stories. One of my favorite people in law enforcement is Tom Goman. And I don't know what that is. I don't know why that is. But this guy is a special guy. And I think that's why he has such an important job. Where I run into him a lot isn't the Metro Gang Task Force. Because obviously we're going after gang members. Gang members make their livelihood on drugs, on dealing drugs, on dealing guns. And if it wasn't for HIDA and for Tom, a lot of the funding that we get for that important task force and for some of the other task forces with the DEA and some of those things, we couldn't do that work. So it's invaluable to the local prosecutors that there is a HIDA, and then HIDA helps fund those important work. With that task force, we work with the FBI. Some of the other task force, we work with federal marshals. Some others, we work with the DEA. But the one constant, and I think really the person that makes those things work, is Tom and HIDA. They have money, which is always helpful, but Tom is always one of those people that when he gives advice and when he tells people what he thinks, everybody in the room listens. People that have been police chiefs for 30 years, me, prosecutors, federal prosecutors, they listen to Tom because they know he knows his business.
So we're going to talk specifically about marijuana, and you've been tracking it for some time and its
right.
impact. Tell me about that process and what you found over the years and the impact of marijuana.
Well, in 2009, about 2009-10, Colorado commercialized medical marijuana. That's when they had dispensaries and grow sites, et cetera. So at that point in time, it was de facto legalization. So we decided to track it to say, what the proponents said, did that happen? What the people are against it, what exactly happened? So we just looked at all the different data sets we could to put together a report, which we did, and it was so well received that we do it every year. We look at whatever data is available. We don't make editorial statements in it. We just report data, none of which comes from us. All of it comes from other agencies like CDOT or Department of Health or the Poison Control. We just report it.
So I know you don't editorialize it, but talk to us about what may concern you the most, some of the things that may be surprising to us.
I don't think it's surprising, because anytime you legalize something, if you use logic and common sense, would tell you what's probably going to happen. You're going to have more people use. When you have more people use, if they have adverse impact, then all those adverse impacts are going to increase. So we've had marijuana-related fatalities have gone up 60-some percent since we legalized it. Our kids are number one in the country for marijuana use, 70-some percent higher than the national average. College kids, about one out of three, 60-some percent higher than the national average. ERs, emergencies, hospitalizations, diversion of Colorado marijuana outside the state, whereas it was supposed to say, okay, if we legalize it, we'll get rid of the black market. We have, in fact, become the black market for so much of the rest of the United States. So all the things that we're a little bit concerned would happen have, in fact, by the data we're able to collect, have, in fact, happened.
Some people might say, are you just anti-drugs, anti-marijuana specifically, and so the data kind of falls in that negative fallout?
It's interesting you say that, because when the report's criticized, they can never criticize a report. They criticize me, and I didn't even put the report together because it's put together by three of our analysts, but it's not our data. It's just whatever data we could find that was available, and we would reach out to people, do you know anything else that's out there that we could report? And so when you can't criticize the data, you have no choice but to criticize me, because I'm a drug warrior and I'm against legalization, that type of stuff. But criticize the data, they can't do that.
So Mitch, Tom is talking about data, and your team actually works with the real life issues on the ground.
We work on the ground, but I felt what Tom has felt. I got invited to a city council meeting a few years back, and I said, why would I come? You're setting a tax on marijuana. I don't know anything about setting taxes. And Charlie Brown at the time said, I want you to talk about the impact of it. I said, seriously? Somebody wants to hear about the negative impact on this city? I said, fine, I'll come. And I came, and I talked about the murders that are directly related to this that go back to 2007. Most of them unsolved. The shootouts in places like neighborhoods in Park Hill directly related to marijuana. And I talked about all those things, and the Denver Post said I was blowing smoke. And in other words, they said I was lying about it, in my view. So what I did in response, used social media, I created a YouTube with a picture of everybody that had been killed directly related to marijuana in this state up to that time. And I actually got so many hits on that YouTube that the Denver Post had to say Morrissey defends himself on YouTube, because I actually used facts, news stories, and the pictures of these poor victims that had been murdered. So I don't know, I guess saying I'm blowing smoke was cute, but it was the wrong thing to do. And what I've found over the course of time is that everybody in this country wants to know what's going on in Colorado. And you know, I introduce myself as the DA of the Amsterdam of the United States, and everybody laughs. But you know, quite frankly, our marijuana laws are much looser than Amsterdam's are, and the impact criminally is just so blatant. But nobody really wants to hear about that. And so when I go to places and talk about this, it's the downside of changing this public policy. And anytime you change a public policy, and you're going to vote on that in California, Arizona, Florida, wherever they're voting on it, they're desperate to find the truth. And the truth is, the impact on the criminal aspect of this, on our law enforcement, you know, the idea that we free up all this police time. Our police officers in Denver are working 10 times, 100 times harder than I'd ever seen them around marijuana. Just the public consumption of marijuana in our city is up 900%. The marijuana that's coming into our crime lab to be tested, the illegally grown marijuana, has gone up over 3,000% in volume. So where they used to bring in pounds, now they bring in tons. So this idea that the black market would go away, that police could focus on other crimes, not too far back, I was on homicide duty for a week. Unfortunately, there were 4 homicides. 3 of them were directly related to marijuana. People were killed because of it. Boys were shot in a backyard because they were stealing plants. Marijuana plants, when I say directly involved in it, it's about the money and the greed And it's about people then going in, invading people's homes to try to get that money, breaking into warehouses to steal this marijuana because it's worth five times what it's worth in Colorado on the streets of New York, New York City, Philadelphia. So when Tom says we are the hub, we clearly are for the black market that then goes out from our state. It's hurting our kids, and it's hurting a lot of victims of crime.
So with the data that you've gathered now, where can other states go? I don't know if we can reverse the clock or if anybody really has the will here in Colorado to reverse the clock and change the laws, but what can other states learn from the data that you're collecting now?
Well, I think Mitch makes a good point. If we're truthful and honest with the public, the other states can look and say, do I want this for my state? Do I want these kind of results for my state? He talked about the Denver Post. Our publication wasn't even covered in the Denver Post, okay? When you talk about the statistics I gave you, which are not ours, not even to have it covered in a major newspaper is a little bit concerning. Not only that, you know, Mitch talks about crime, but you heard Mayor Hancock when he talked about the urban traveler. These homelessness has gone up, they come into town, they harass people. When 49% of your event planners who bring conventions that have a negative view of Denver because of pot smoking, homelessness, safety on, when the PD has put triple the number of cops downtown, when businesses have to spend $1 million to hire security, that's a major impact. And that's not even data. Those are real live fact impacts. But where do you hear that from?
So when you're out talking to people, both of you, civic groups, schools, churches, public groups, or whatever, are people surprised to hear this data? Are they shocked, or do they even care?
Well, there's a lot of money involved in this. And I think that oftentimes people are willing to say, hey, we can go into the warehouse business and make an awful lot of money here. And I think there's a disconnect between that business and the impact on that kid that Denver Public Schools is trying to get to graduate from high school. You know, we have groups of kids in our community that don't graduate from high school now. Getting them stoned is gonna help. I mean, sadly, the kids in Denver use marijuana over twice the national average. And that's little kids, a lot of little kids. So, I mean, Tom's passionate about this, you can see, and so am I. But I think that, again, when you have a voter making a decision, you need to be honest with them. And you need to give them the negative side of this. There is a negative side of this. I debated one of the main architects of all these campaigns around the country. You'd be shocked, but he's from Denver. And he's a nice man, and I've known him for a long time. I debated him over at DU, and I talked about the negative impact. And the first question the moderator, Floyd Cerulli, asked him was, in fact, you were there.
Yep.
And Floyd asked him, well, do you hear what Mitch is saying around the country in these campaigns that you're running? He says, no. And he says, it's very important that we do. Because if people are going to decide this and change public policy, have the kind of impact on kids, and have the impact on driving, and have the types of impacts that we're talking about, they need to know this. And I thought that was great. I really thought that was important. But there is a huge industry out there that doesn't want the truth out. They spend a lot of money to keep the truth from being told. And I always tell the lawyers that represent these guys, are you telling them to set aside a big trust fund, a big set of money? And they look at me and they go, why? When the class action lawyers come after them, like they did the tobacco industry, and they sue them for millions and millions of dollars. Now, I may be gone, and Tom's a little older than I am, so we'll be gone. But there will be a time where this industry will have to pay for the lies and for the misinformation and hiding it to make money. And again, it's the greed that bothers me. I'm proud of being from Colorado. I'm proud of my grandparents all being born in this state. This I find to be one of the hardest things I've ever dealt with in the place where I'm from and proud of. And when all people want to talk about is, how's that pot going? So what I tell people in Florida, California, Utah, Nevada, he dragged me out to Las Vegas to talk to them one time, is wait and see. Mm-hmm. You know, why? What's the rush? You have these places like Colorado, Oregon, Washington. See how it goes there and then vote on it. What's the rush? Because things aren't going all that well here in Colorado around this. And people don't want to hear it, and people get really upset with us, but we're telling the truth.
We've got to take a quick break here. We're here with Tom Goman with the Rocky Mountain HIDA talking about the impact of marijuana in the long term. Back in just a moment.
Life is made of moments. Family. A drunk driver could take it all away. Keep your family safe on the road, because after all, nothing is more beautiful. Mothers Against Drunk Driving. Keep your family safe.
Welcome back to Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. This is the portion of the show where we talk about a term, and today's term is alternate defense counsel. And the definition is the Office of Alternate Defense Counsel provides legal representation for people who qualify for a public defender, but for whom there is a conflict, such as a co-defendant being represented by a public defender. So, Mitch, what does that really mean? Break that down for us.
Well, we have a public defender system in the state of Colorado. In fact, we have one of the best in the country. And it's when someone's indigent and can't pay for a lawyer. There's private lawyers out there that do criminal defense, and they charge for their services. Public defender is free for the defendants. It's not free for the taxpayers. But there's a good office. It's across the state. But what happens oftentimes is you'll have two or more people then charged in the same case, and they're all indigent, or at least they're claiming they are. And so what do you do when the public defender has a conflict? So what the state of Colorado did was they created an office of counsel that can then take over and represent the other indigent person. So if you had three defendants, you'll have a public defender and two alternate counsel. And they're private attorneys that are on a list that get paid by the state then to represent indigent people. So it helps us with that whole idea that everybody, and everybody does, has a right to counsel even if you can't afford one. And this is the way Colorado deals with that situation when the public defender can only represent one of them. And that's all the time. They can't take the other two, the other one, because they would have a conflict there having two public defenders on the same case representing two different defendants who may have different defenses.
That's interesting. I didn't realize that the public defender's office couldn't defend multiple people, but it's just one person.
One person per case.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, let's bring back our guest here, Tom Goman, the director of Rocky Mountain HIDA. Again, thanks so much for being here. This is a very interesting conversation. We've been focusing on marijuana, but that's just one of the drugs that Rocky Mountain HIDA works with. Talk about some of the other drugs that are out there that you work with.
Well, what we're seeing here in Colorado, in fact, we're doing a study right now similar to what we did on marijuana, is what is happening with heroin. We know back east heroin, fentanyl has become a major, major problem, number of overdose deaths, etc. So we're doing what we call a threat assessment to examine what's going on in Colorado and what can we do together with prevention, treatment, and law enforcement, all working together to impact that problem. So we're probably about 3 or 4 months into that. And actually, interesting enough, we're interviewing heroin users to get their input on how they feel, how they started, what they think would work, et cetera. So it should be an interesting three disciplines come together long overdue.
Talk a little bit more about how you're working with heroin users to help others.
Well, we're doing surveys. We have a couple treatment places that are doing a survey for us, and then we're doing it at the methadone clinics, and we're surveying the people. And we thought, are they going to be willing to talk to us? It's amazing. They want to talk. They want to give their view and how they started and what they think may or may not work. So that'll be coming out probably after the first year, and I'm excited about all of us working together for the common good. So.
And I understand a number of addicts are veterans who come out after being in Iraq or Afghanistan, and they didn't get hooked there necessarily, but because of their treatment here back home, they got addicted to drugs, and that's how they got addicted onto some other drugs.
Yeah, they'll go up to the VA. The VA will prescribe drugs for them. They give them the drugs. They get addicted to those drugs, and then the prescription runs out. And unfortunately, or unfortunately, heroin's cheaper than most opioids on the street, and so they turn to heroin. And heroin is dangerous. Obviously, for years we've dealt with heroin addicts, but not at the level that we have now, because heroin is easier to use now. You know, when I was a kid, you had to shoot it. You know, when I was a teenager, you had to stick a needle in your arm. You don't have to do that now with heroin. You can snort it, you can smoke it, you can take it in probably more acceptable ways, and eventually you're going to have to shoot it. That's what it's going to come down to. But that's, I think, part of what we're seeing. It's easier to use it, and it's cheaper, and people are addicted to something that I think we could really cut into if we did things like talk to the pharmaceutical companies in this country, talk to the doctors that may be over-prescribing these opioids, and getting that cut down. We had Tom Brewster on the show not too long ago, and he talked about that. And, you know, he does treatment. He does incredible work at The Haven and Pier One, two of the best treatment programs we have in the state of Colorado, maybe in the United States. And he gets very passionate when he talks about over-prescribing these things. And people that keep them around and their kids then are breaking into their parents' medicine cabinets and getting addicted to these opioids, and then that becomes heroin and heroin addicts. So it's a big problem, and we need to work on it nationally, and it's important that Tom is tracking the same kind of data. You know, how many people are overdosing, how many people are going to emergency rooms, how many kids are getting poisoned, all the things that he's doing around marijuana, pulling together all those different agencies that have that information to show an overall impact. And that's what you need to know.
Mm-hmm. You really need to get a comprehensive.
You know the one thing, though, that bothers me about data is people. And we seem to forget that. We say there's been a 15% increase in overdose. That's somebody's daughter, somebody's son, mom or dad or whatever. And we tend not to personalize data. And so many times, a young kid that he was a veteran college graduate addicted to marijuana ended up committing suicide. And his suicide note said, "Marijuana ruined my brain, destroyed my soul. I need to set my parents free." He knew the impact it was having on his parents. So usually we think suicide's selfish. In this case, he wanted to set as the college student from Mesa State that smoked a joint, ended up killing an 8-year-old girl. That officer that goes to that door and says, "Mr. So-and-so, you'll never walk your daughter down the aisle. That soccer game she's got 2 weeks from now, you're not going to be going to it. You're going to be going to a memorial service." And that's the problem. We throw out stats. We need to throw out. These are real people. And when we talk about the people killed on our highways and interstates, that should not be acceptable to us. We need to lower that and instead of glorifying whether it be alcohol, marijuana, whatever.
No, actually, we did. Before we legalized marijuana in this state, we were actually seeing decreases in the deaths, alcohol-related, drug-related deaths on our highways. That's gone way back up. So all the hard work that we put in place, and I think that the viewers were probably getting a sense of the frustration that Tom and I feel. You know, I can tell you about the boy that was shot in the back and paralyzed and his friend killed. You know, I was out there. I saw that over some marijuana plants that they were stealing from a backyard. You know, I saw those things. Those are the kind of cases that are pending in Denver around marijuana. Those boys were 15 and 14 years old. They were trying to get into a dance at Manual about a few hours before they ended up shot and paralyzed, murdered and paralyzed. I mean, those are the kinds of things that we're seeing, you know, and to see that and to hear that and to watch the homicide detectives work so hard to try to solve those cases, people beaten with crowbars for the money that they can get, the proceeds, all of those are the things that we're seeing that are real around marijuana, obviously around heroin, and these narcotics and all of the things that we talk about. So I think that's why we're so passionate about it, because mm-hmm. they're ruining people's lives, and the crime rate's going up. You've got people coming in from all over the country that are then homeless on our streets. The 16th Street Mall, Tom talked about that a little bit. Many of these things are directly related to the legalization of marijuana in the state of Colorado and the city of Denver.
And the thing about law enforcement is we're first responders. We see the victim like nobody else does. And it tugs at your heart. You can't cry when you're there at the scene. You can't cry when you go tell the parents what's happened. But we're first responders. So we see the results of all this. And that's why we're so passionate about it. Nobody deserves to be a victim.
Right.
You don't deserve to be a victim.
And Tom, so there's you, and you mentioned three analysts. Talk about all the numbers of people on your team and who are they, what they do.
That do this report?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I have three analysts and call it Strategic Intelligence Unit. Mm-hmm. We have a tactical, which helps the cops put together cases. They have a strategical that looks at trends and et cetera. So that unit is the one that puts this publication together. They go out and talk to the health department. And interesting enough, everything we put out, we will generally, if we can, except for the SAMHSA data, we will give it back to the agency to make sure that it's accurate, make sure we have all the caveats that we have to have on it, whether it's CDOT or whoever it is, so that nobody can criticize our data.
And you can get their reports online, which is what I always like. So when they come out with a new report, if you go to Rocky Mountain HIDA, just Google it, and you get to their homepage, there'll be a reports. Mm-hmm. And it's more than the marijuana reports, it's other reports that Tom's team puts together. Click on that and you can see the different reports and the different years and the trends and the things that have happened as far as increase, those types of things. And you know, this team of people that they pulled together, you know, the Rocky Mountain Poison Center, so we know how many kids are being poisoned by marijuana, all those kinds of things, that data's there. It's important data to read. It really shouldn't be ignored. And so I want to thank Tom for coming on.
Yeah, and really accessible. And Tom, thanks so much for all the hard work that you do.
For Mitch, I would do anything.
And I heard you were a character, so we had to have you on the show. Thank you to Tom Goman, director of the Rocky Mountain High Intensity Drug Trafficking Area, for joining us today on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. We'll see you next time. Thanks for being here.